Margarette Lawson. Margarette Lawson is my mother, and I have watched her as an artist all my life. It's a pleasure to be with her today and to have her tell us about some of the things that we're going to see, some of the artistic pieces that we're going to see here at her studio site. Hi, Margarette.
Hi, Candee.
It's good to see you today.
Wonderful.
I thought we'd start today with your sculpture garden, which you have set out here so beautifully. Tell us about the large piece right behind you.
What, this one?
Yes.
Well, I don't really know whether it's finished or not.
Oh, that's very interesting, because that's one of the main questions we're trying to explore.
Yes.
Is how do you know when a piece is done?
Well, I know when it satisfies me, when it says what I think it should say. And I'm not sure that this glaze alone, underpainting or glaze alone, is enough.
I see.
It has to be a part of the piece and yet emphasize where the piece came from. And to me, it doesn't quite do that yet. But with this kind of piece, you can glaze and fire and glaze and fire as long as you wish.
What is the media that's made from?
Oh, this is clay.
It's a clay piece.
Yes, this is clay. High fire.
High fire clay.
Yes.
And the glazes? Is there anything special about them?
No. They're just colors that I like.
I see.
Nothing special.
I see. How long have you been sculpting?
Well, the first sculpture that I ever made was, I must have been 4 years old. Maybe five.
Oh my goodness. Do you remember it?
Well, sure. I was with Daddy.
Uh-huh.
And it had rained very, very heavily.
Uh-huh.
And since I wasn't in school, I always begged to go with him when he delivered. Well, this particular time, the roads were terrible. So the car wouldn't make it.
Uh-huh.
So he hitched up Dan in the buggy, put his mail in it, picked up me, and away we went.
Right.
And there was on his route a particular hill that was Clay Hill. And he stopped the buggy and got out and got me some clay. And
so that you would have something to do?
And he warned me that if I did with the clay, I couldn't put the mail in the mailbox. But I wanted to do the clay. So I said, okay, I won't touch it. And he got the clay, and I made a dog.
You made a dog?
A dog.
Your first piece. Your dog.
And we took it home, and my grandmother loved it and put it on her mantle in the bedroom, front bedroom. And there it sat for years and years and years. I don't know what has finally happened to it, but
as far as you know, it never broke?
It didn't break as long as she had it. Now, when my grandfather died and she moved away from the farm, I don't know what happened to it.
Uh-huh.
And I wasn't into keeping anything.
Right. Let's look at some more of your pieces that you have here in the sculpture garden.
Well,
I'm going to zoom in on them a little bit.
Of course, sidetracked after I made the dog with drawing.
Right, and so, you kept on drawing and drawing and drawing.
Yes, I can't remember not drawing.
You can never remember not drawing?
No.
So when did you get back into sculpture as an adult?
Oh, some years ago. I just decided I wanted to play with the mud.
And you started with clay again.
I started with the high fire clays. And I did a haiku piece. The large one over here is haiku, which is a different form of firing and is not necessarily
The one that's in the front?
It's this, no.
Point it out.
This is her.
Which one is the haiku?
It's the one in the back.
All right. Now, why is it called haiku?
Well, it is fired quickly in a... In this case, we used a great big heavy-duty can.
Uh-huh.
And, of course, the piece is brought up to a certain temperature, and then it is put into this can with material that burns.
Uh-huh.
Wood, or I think we used wood in different things, and it's fired. So it never quite reaches the high fire temperature of the other things, but because it's fired in the can with natural materials, touching it, actually
right.
being a part of it, it then has the burned look. And parts of it touch more, parts of it are gray, parts of it go off into the brown, and parts of it are more charcoal-y looking. And it's just a fun thing, and you take what you get. And so we had a lot of fun with that. And I have another piece.
And then you have all these small pieces.
Yes, I decided I want to make me some flowers that didn't have to be watered. So all of these are flower forms.
That don't have to have any water put on them.
And there's some that aren't in here. There's one up in the bathroom section outside our shower area. And I think Dad still has some tucked in his workshop. But these, that's what I was doing. And of course these use a different kind of glaze. They really have a gloss to them.
How does the media that you're working with dictate what you can do or not do in your sculpture?
Well, with clay, you can do just about anything you want to do.
I see. So it's a very flexible, forgiving medium?
Very. Well, once it's fired, it's not forgiving. You got it. That's it. But as far as working with it, you can put on and take off and add to as long as you keep it structurally together.
I see.
In other words, you, between you working on it, you cover it with a piece of plastic to keep it moist.
Mm-hmm.
Or something like that.
Mm-hmm. So it doesn't dry out.
Yeah. Once it dries out, you better fire it.
Right.
So those are some of the fun things I've done, just literally relaxing and having fun.
So for you, this sculpture is a means of delight and entertainment and...
Very much so. Uh-huh. Very much so. And there's no way... Now, there are some women who find this kind of work with their hands making bread, doing bread dough.
Uh-huh.
But I much prefer mud. So that's the way it is.
Okay. Let's take a look over here now. We brought out from the studio two pieces that you're working on that are, well, they appear to be combinations of painting and sculpture.
Yes, I call them my tripod paintings, but they are three-dimensional. You were supposed to show these so you can walk around and see how these earth forms connect with a form that may be on the other side of the globe. It has without using the globe, it has a, I hope, a continuation of the earth from one section to the other, from one country to the other.
Let's put it down so that I can circle around it with the camera. Put it down on the wood.
Down here?
Uh-huh.
Oh, all right.
Great.
I think.
Let me just circle around it so that.
Okay. Now I can. Yes, I think perhaps. If you want me to turn it slightly.
Yeah, go ahead.
To get full sun.
Keep turning it.
I think perhaps that would help you.
Mm-hmm.
Since our lighting is not studio conceived here. We'll pretend it's on a turnstile.
Very nice.
And just gently.
And what gave you the idea to do this?
Well, I don't know. Where do ideas come from?
That's one of my questions. Where do you get your ideas?
Ideas happen when you allow them to happen.
Ideas happen when you allow them to happen.
When you are creative, are thinking through, if you preconceive an answer, you're stuck.
Uh-huh.
But if you have an idea of what I did to make a painting that was three-dimensional, that would almost be sculpture, but I don't think it is, because the form is simply a kind of a static form, then you just let it grow. You let it happen. And that's the way it is with any creative process. Where the idea originates, maybe it's from being here and seeing all the forms of nature that I live with every day.
Being here meaning your studio, which
meaning
looks
here,
over this canyon.
This, yes. It is, you can't be down here by yourself in the quiet with the stream making its noise in the background, the mountains and the trees and the wonderful view that I have, and the obnoxious cane that is choking the stream, and not think of some of the things that we could use cane for.
And you have used cane here as your legs.
It's
the form.
The backbone.
It's the backbone of the form. Uh-huh. And what is it that you've stretched around it?
Well, these forms are resin.
Uh-huh.
I make my shapes of glass cloth and resin stretched out on plastic on that table.
Why don't you come show us this one that's on the table?
Yeah.
Because
okay.
You can see, I think, the cloth you're speaking of.
A very rough piece.
Right, because you haven't trimmed the cloth, right?
No, well, you can see the legs, the cane legs that go all the way up. And I originally made a form with a square bottom, but I decided I didn't like that. Now, the nice thing about this glass cloth and resin is you're not stuck. So I made another form to add some difference to the bottom, because there's no square edge in nature, not really. That's man-made. So I've done this, which of course it will take some more work to tie it into here. But then, as you can see how it's wrapped.
Yes.
And secured, which of course is still rough. And then the edge will come up and around and down, and I may leave this very interesting little loop here. I don't know yet. That's the nice part about allowing yourself to be creative, is when things happen and you step back, you say, that's it, and let it go. And this is the piece.
And it's hard to explain that's it moment, isn't it? I mean,
when you are a beginning artist, maybe studying, taking lessons, and you have an instructor who has certain strict guidelines, shall we say, then you depend on him to say that's
or her.
It, or her. Him or her, I'm not worried about gender. Anyway, you depend upon that person to tell you, because you're still feeling your way.
Right.
But after a while, you get tired of their voice. And you look at it and you think, I'm going to leave. That's it. And no matter what they say, you don't really absorb it.
And in how, I guess what I'm interested in is that place, that passing over place where ownership, you said finding your own voice, you find your own voice. I'm interested in that place, in a person's, in an artist's development, in a person's development.
Well, it's an evolution.
It is, isn't it?
Yes, it's an evolution. You will be at that almost place for a while, and there'll be some times that you evolve it on your own. There'll be other times you can't quite make up your mind and you will listen again.
Right. And how do you find the transference from one medium to another? With respect to your confidence, your understanding of when it's done, of what it needs. You know, you, as a...
Well, if I were a beginning, I don't know. I didn't ask anybody when my dog was done and I was 5 years old. It was done.
Yeah, that's what I'm hearing, is that you've known that really for all the time.
It's done when it's done. I mean, that's all you want. Actually, it falls down to that's all you want to do to it. You don't want to add anything. You don't want to take anything away. It is. Huh? Whatever it is you're working on, sculpture, painting, something new, it is when it is, when it has become. So I don't know. I don't think that education can test that.
Mm-hmm.
So far, they can't even test creativity. They make a stab at it, but it's pretty feeble. Well, it is. It's very difficult because you can't put down in black and white where these ideas come from.
Right. I mean, this piece in front of us, could you turn it one more time so we can
sure.
see the third sign?
Sure.
And it's in progress.
It's in progress.
Yes. And what is the media that you're, the paint media that you're working
it's
with
It's acrylic,
here?
But it mixes with resin. It's fantastic. Your resin doesn't set up, you know, real fast. So you squeeze in the paint, squish it around, and here are these wonderful things that happen.
So it's liquid resin.
Yes, it's you. Have the resin and put the hardener in, but before it sets,
I see.
You spread it or poured it on your glass cloth, on a heavy piece of plastic because it peel off the plastic.
Yeah, I see.
It peels right off once it's set.
Mm-hmm.
And into that shape, you look at the shape that you have formed, and you begin to put paint.
And you have control of this paint putting, or
you have
are there accidents that happen?
There are always accidents that happen.
Uh-huh.
And sometimes they're good, and sometimes they're bad.
Uh-huh.
But if they're not what you want, you simply move it around, go over.
Move it around.
Yeah.
So are there surprises that happen too that are keep?
Yes, very definitely. And there are things that you get from paint being mixed in with the resin.
Can you point out an example of that on this piece?
Let's see. Show. Probably up in here would be one area where I put the, can you see that?
Yes, I've zoomed right in on it.
Okay. Up in here, you see how it moves?
Yes.
And then something made it change. Now, in watercolor, you can make these funny little sections happen by throwing salt into your watercolor wet, and or you can throw watercolor and use your saran wrap and clump it up. But in acrylic and resin, it happens.
I see. So you have to watch for that happening.
Watch for the happening, because these are things that tell you when it is going to be successful.
And is there a connection with your feelings that are happening as you're watching? Does that help you know when it's right and when it's not right?
That, it's an accumulation of feeling for the media and a whole lifetime of looking at art and thinking about art and all of those things that you think art is. And it's a whole accumulation of, and a melding together of emotion, past knowledge, knowledge that you're gaining from working with the piece, and it all comes together.
I see. Now, these are non-representational pieces that you're doing.
I started out making things look like things.
So your dog is an example.
Oh, yes.
And then you got into drawing, and, yes, and you drew and what you saw.
Yes, I did. And then when I was a painter and went into landscape, at first I was content with finding a particular landscape or a particular mood that that landscape evoked and trying to get it on canvas with the paint.
Mm-hmm.
And once I felt I had done that enough, it wasn't me. There are parts of this earth, if we will look, there are sections of banks and cliffs and waters and trees that when you use like your eyes as though they were a little microscope, you go right in on that, then in that one small segment is all of what landscape is, God's creation.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't see it when you're looking at a beautiful scene someone has painted. Your senses are appealed to by the sea, by the tree, by the stream, by the cloud, by the whatever. But if you look deeper and further than that and want to say the earth is composed of lots of things, then you've got to go abstract.
I see. Then you have to go non-representational, because you're looking at the shape and the form and the color, and you're feeling
it. How it was formed.
How it was formed.
How it was formed. Where did it come from? Was it hot? Melty? Was it cold? Did it solidify? What happened?
This is what Margaret sees when she stands on the deck looking out from her studio door. Hi, Margaret. Here we are, and we're going to enter into her studio, and she's going to show us a little bit more about how she starts a work. There's a work on her easel that really is just a beginning.
Yes, come on in. Also, look at the view out my window, which is framed so nicely. with paint and brushes and outside tree and mountains.
Yes, it is. So this is her studio. It's small, but very inviting, very organized. Her papers.
My glass for my monoprints is protected here. And I'll turn off my, I leave it on cable radio all the time. And these are papers. These are the watercolor papers. These are glass, not glass cloth, but rice papers and papers that are soft enough for monoprints to absorb quickly. These are monoprints that I didn't use. For instance, you remember Pisces.
Yes.
Pisces that I didn't use, but of course a collagist always saves. They're wonderful areas in here.
Areas? I take the piece home.
Well, and here,
but I've been doing that all my life.
Here's another one.
Oh.
That probably came pretty close to being okay.
Yes, it's very nice.
Yeah. So, but it wasn't quite what I wanted. So, anyway.
And those are monoprints.
Yes. And here's one test monoprint for Libra.
She's referring to a series that she did of zodiac signs, monoprints that were the signs of the zodiac.
Yeah. And I have some drawings in here. For instance, somewhere I've got Taurus. Yeah, I don't know. Taurus crawled off, I guess. But he's in there. You know, the drawing that I put underneath the glass.
Right.
So that I could.
And these are, this is an older piece over here on.
Now this is. This,
no, up high, the lemon.
Oh yeah, that's my hard edge period.
That's when she used to paint using what she calls the hard edge style.
When the studio burned, I lost a lot of work.
Yes, that was in the fire of 1980.
Yes.
But, right. And then on the wall here, you were about to tell us about this little
what?
Bit of palette.
Oh, no.
It looks like palette.
It is palette, and it's pretty. It's a mess, but that's what it looks like when you get through with it. This is the a haiku piece.
Well, I like it.
Yes.
Oh, the palette.
Well, this is the haiku piece that I can't show outside because it is to go this way.
I see.
And the water will get down in here.
Right.
And there's no way. So it makes a very nice
piece for the studio.
Yeah. And now here are some smaller sketches. Now here's Taurus. Which
was the beginning sketch for that zodiac series.
When we go upstairs, I can show you the Taurus.
Right.
It came out.
Right.
This is Gemini, the twins.
Hold them up a little bit, please.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
And here we go, Capricorn. Virgo. But these are just simply line drawings of how Virgo would be. If you remember, she sewed all of the wonderful colors.
Oh yes, this is just the, really, this is like your
the backbone.
Your beginning.
You flesh out the backbone. And of course here's a raw beginning of Sagittarius. And Sagittarius gone by the wayside, I don't know.
Sold.
Oh,
not gone by the wayside, sold.
Well, yeah. Sometimes I make little black and white sketches like that. They don't have any meaning to anybody but me. But that's my...
Now you can visualize from that little sketch, though, what it's going...
Yeah, now if...
What was that in your hand there?
Oh, it was a little collage starting type thing that I might work with some different areas in here with some, I sort of.
You've glued that, that's a piece that
that's
you.
That's glued paper.
Glued collage. Paper, and so it's a design, an idea for a collage.
Yeah. I'll probably go through changes, but anyway, it's a start. Here is a, sometimes, see, I'll make the little black and white sketch.
Right.
And it's tiny. And then I come up with a collage. And you recognize this one, which is the dig.
It's the dig.
Which changes.
Yes.
But basically the same kind of thing.
Right.
So you can
and
see.
These are papers that you've cut.
Oh yeah, just anywhere I can find a paper with a color.
Right.
That I want. But,
So that's part of your process.
That's part of the process. I found these so I could show it to you.
Good.
That's lucky because I don't always keep the processes. I don't know whether I've got any up here or not. Yeah, I got a couple. I just
thank you.
Here's a little sketch, acrylic sketch,
uh-huh.
that can work up into a major 4x5 foot or so. Painting.
From that little sketch, yeah. You would go to a 4x5.
Oh, yeah.
Four by five.
It's not any problem. The reason is when I make my.
Turn it straight there.
When I make my colors or make my papers
uh-huh.
for the collage or make my resin piece, you see the texture begins to come.
Right.
The different textures. So it's not flat. Uh-huh. Not flat at all.
Right.
And subtly it changes. Right now this is the dominant area and it might be remain so, but it certainly will have some help.
Something else will happen as it grows
yeah,
larger.
Yeah, yeah, as it gets larger. There is there's been a little many millions of words written on size.
Mm-hmm.
How important is size to say what you want to say?
Interesting.
And I find that I have a tendency to think in terms of a larger size.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know why.
Now what is this other little freeform piece hanging on the wall here?
That?
Yes.
Oh, that's something that I have begun, and it hasn't done. I think I was inspired by the bare branches of the trees in the winter
mm-hmm.
to make them into a form of landscape, but it hasn't.
Those are actual sticks in there,
oh,
too,
yeah.
aren't they?
Those are sticks. Now, they will remain okay. As long as they're coated with a resin.
I see. So you have coated them.
Uh-huh. And I may have to coat again. I don't know what will mm-hmm. happen to that piece. Mm-hmm. Goodness knows. But I just threw it up there as a part
it's nice.
Of the interview to
right,
show
nice.
That it that things do happen.
Mm-hmm.
And you do get inspired from your surroundings.
We're looking now at a piece that is a collage piece, and it is just beginning.
Just beginning, because I think it's going to be a diptych with another section here.
A diptych meaning two paintings that go together.
Parts. Uh-huh. Uh-huh, and I won't separate. Lots of times I separate them, but I won't separate these except with perhaps a color or a texture, but I will use some of these colors and come into this and have this side probably running like the streams or something. I'm not sure yet, but it probably will be that kind of thing as a foil and as a emphasis of this form as opposed to this.
And again, how does the media that you're working with allow you to revise, allow you to change?
Yeah. Now here's a paper I made that I'm...
Now you made this.
Yes. And I'm not sure what I want. You can see the marks of it lying on the screen to dry. But I haven't decided. That piece is so interesting that I'll...
The shape itself.
The shape and the texture of the piece that I have to maintain that along with whatever I use it with.
So the pieces themselves
talk
to you about how to use
yes.
them.
Oh, yes. And here's some... Here is some heavily textured black, which when black is used this way, and it's, of course I have already used the pieces out of here, it takes on a life of its own. Now, oh, there are purists who would never use black. Well, black is a color, and it's a wonderful color. So I use it as I please when it does what I want it to do. There's some more rice paper that's different. But the kids love to get into my papers, which I don't let them very often.
She's referring to her great-grandchildren. She has 4 great-grandchildren.
Anyway, I had an idea to use these pieces. And they still may come about.
You see.
You see. Because on, as a part of, we'll just use this as a structure to put it on. They take on an interest that's very earthy.
Yes, it is. Do you work that way a lot, where you'll just start arranging things?
Oh, sure. I do. There's not any set way to work other than to get an idea and see what you can do with it. And if you need to stop a minute and arrange, then you stop and arrange. Now, here's some pieces I textured. I was having fun. I don't know what I'll use them for, but they're kind of interesting.
Now, Margaret, how does this work make you feel when you are in down here in your studio? And
I love it. I don't think of anything else but what I'm doing.
It's as if you've gone away
and shut it off
into another world.
Right.
And it's a world that does what for you?
I guess it keeps me centered from flying off.
And does it feed you and
nourish me? Yes. I always defend. It helps the family because after a good day in the studio, I go up and I'm so pleasant. There's no problem.
I've never known her not to be pleasant, so that's kind of an interesting comment.
I'm...
You feel good inside.
I feel better inside, and it comes out with whatever.
So do you think there's a kind of a release that goes on from creating?
There is when it's going well. When it's not going well, and you keep trying, and it isn't there, and you think, So the best thing to do, if I have a piece that I'm stuck on, I simply put it aside and pick up another one.
I see. So distance and separation is a very...
You come back to it the next day and you see what you want to do with it.
Right.
Or even a month from then, or even whatever. You know, it's not going to go away.
Right.
And the basic idea is there. It's up to you to feel it again. So, and you come down and paint if you have.
You do. You come down and paint.
Whether I have an idea going in my head or not, I walk into this studio, I put something on the easel or on the table, or pick up a piece of paper and take it out there and texture it. And though I maybe didn't particularly have anything in mind or didn't even maybe want to come, I come. And then it happens.
So there's a discipline that's involved also.
Very much so. Mm-hmm. It's not something that you wait for the moon to move you.
Mm-hmm.
You work. It's work. Mm-hmm. You work. Pleasant and wonderful though it is for me, it's still work.
Right.
And you do it.
Right. And we're going to talk about some different issues and questions that have come up in my thinking and study of creativity. So one of the things that we started talking about down below was your process. You were showing us some sketches, and you were talking about how you went from a basic black and white line sketch to a collage type of work. So what I'm interested in is you talking a bit more about your process and how you go from idea, wherever that came from,
yes, nobody knows,
to actualizing it out so that you wind up with a finished piece.
Well, I still can't tell you where the ideas come from. It's in the funny papers, in the cartoons, they have light bulbs going off.
I noticed that you have a file of all kinds of bits and pieces.
Things that appeal to me, things that I like about other artists. And I do, from time to time, just rest and take a trip to an art gallery where all this fine art is by just simply looking.
So again, attending, looking, observing, letting it go into your mind.
Right, and spiel around in there and come out another way. So that's basically.
So would you say that synthesis, that taking pieces from here and pieces from there and letting them sift and simmer in your mind has something to do with the idea process?
It happens automatically, and you're not sure it's happening other than all of a sudden this is your idea. Now,
and do they come to you in pictures, your ideas, your visuals?
Sure.
Okay. So it's nonverbal,
it's
your ideas.
It's very nonverbal. Uh-huh. I have a difficult time verbalizing about the process because it happens. It just is.
Okay. And you have some more sketches, I think, here, some things that
never necessarily materialized, but now I just was playing with these things.
These are old photos of Margaret that she was playing with to see if she might get an idea or...
I don't know why I did it. I think I wanted just to see what a Xerox machine would do.
Okay.
And you never know what might come from that. And I just did some color sketches of, I think this is a sort of a takeoff on some sort of still life. I don't know, but it looks like it.
Yes.
Maybe.
And these are older pieces.
They're older. They went through the fire. You can see the burned edges.
Uh-huh.
How they were preserved, I don't know, but they were.
We're looking at these bits and pieces.
Just sketches that you can see I've been organically inclined for a long time.
Because these go back even before 1980.
Yes, yes. And... this probably started out as a traditional landscape, but it's never functioned as anything really, but it's kind of fun. And here is a
Another piece.
Patriotic Clifford Still. Oh, there's my dog, Pepper.
He was a miniature schnauzer.
Yeah, that was nostalgia. That's Pepper.
Mm-hmm.
That's all.
So these were some.
These are things that have been in my head a long time.
Right.
So it comes out with this one behind and the all different sorts of things. They gel around and swirl around and see where it was burned.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. How does a painting or a piece of art change from the process of working on it?
Well, you saw a beginning of a piece.
Right.
And perhaps next time you'll see a change.
Now, the one that was on the white board down there.
Yes, the beginning.
The beginning. The size of the piece isn't going to change because...
Probably not.
Because
I've decided I'm going to make that size.
Okay. But what might change are the shapes and the forms and...
Yes. It's got to change.
It has to change.
It has to change. Change is a part of growth. Although all change is not good. And sometimes you have to put it back.
Uh-huh. But your part of your process automatically includes change.
Automatically. Now, this is my collage sketch with paint and... Actually, they're different colors, but I think I painted over them, of the finished painting that turns out to be 4 feet by 5 feet, and it's on the wall over there, and it's called The Door. The Red Door.
Right, and I will get it on
This is the... I had the idea from beach areas. We had been to San Diego and prowled around and where the beaches are, where the houses are, and they're really quite close together, and some have been there many years, and they're textured, and some are well kept and some are not, but they're all kind of jumbled together, and once in a while there is one that is really pretty far gone, but it still maintains its bright red door.
It has the door.
But I didn't see that. That's me. Bright red doors are important. I love red, so anyway. Now this is another sketch that I made just on paper with acrylic. And there are many ways you can look at it. And it works. It works. I haven't made it into a bigger piece yet, but it will happen someday.
This notion of turning it all different ways.
Oh, it's very important.
That's a part of the process.
That's part of the process.
Is it a part of the way to see the piece?
Yes, yes. Also, I don't think you noticed in the studio, there's a mirror on one wall. And if you hold it up in front of the mirror, everything is reversed.
Right.
In the mirror. And then you turn it, and there again helps you to see or to feel that, oh, I like it this way, but this doesn't work. I better change that.
Huh.
So you do that. You help yourself to see. Here's a charcoal drawing that might be kind of interesting.
Now this is another sketch technique.
Sketch, collage.
Because you've taken pieces of paper.
Just different colors. And started working. Now actually, I'll tell you what this is.
It's one of those pieces?
It's one of my pieces that I did for the show. Yes.
That was the beginning of a piece.
It is the beginning of a piece that is three feet by 4 feet, or no, it's 2 feet by 4 feet, especially a horizontal piece. But it is this is all textured with the sand. See, it isn't here.
No.
But in my head it was.
You saw it.
Yeah, I felt that.
You felt, you could see it and feel it, and you knew what you wanted to use in order to create
yes,
the image you were looking for.
I had the potential to do that.
And I'm going to move in on the little piece. Yeah, that's right. Hold it like that. Good. Then see the entire piece in its finished
form. And the center of this piece, where the earth and the water and everything is forming in the center of the earth, is a resin piece.
Ah, that you did separately.
Oh yes, oh yes. This is a collage, it builds up. This piece was made on my blue table because I can't, large pieces I work outside. And of course the patio's large enough to do that. And blue table, and this is sand with color, and I knew what I wanted. And this is another paper, and this is a resin paper, and the black is another kind of paper, so that all of these different papers give a feeling of their own life. At least I hope they do. They do to me, which is important. And then when the colors juxtapose, it's easier for you to see the shapes and how they move and interact with one another.
Uh-huh.
Now this, of course, that is in the sketch has neither the texture nor the excitement that the piece that I did has to use as this piece.
But you have a mental image that went along with the sketch?
Yeah, but the idea of the center of the universe, or the earth, as being water and fire and movement, I wanted in the middle section.
Right, and you got it.
And it was easier to get with a resin piece than a flat piece.
Right. Now, I'm curious about, so when you start to work, you have a conceptualization.
I did for this, and I do for most.
For most pieces. You have some kind of a conceptualization.
Now that may change.
Right. But when you finally finish the piece, when you reach completion on the piece.
Yes.
And it's gone through the different changes. How has the media itself affected the process of the changing?
Well, that's difficult to explain in words, but
I mean, do you take the pieces and lay them different ways like you were showing me down in the studio?
I can. That may be a part of this particular piece. Certainly I changed the shape of this section.
Yes.
Because in the larger piece, this section, I changed it to interact with the other pieces that are around it here.
Uh-huh.
That were more important than just this first vision I had.
Right. So as you worked with the form and the
basic,
colors.
Basic idea, like I've said, you have a basic idea. And maybe you've put
it's
down.
It's an image.
Put very definitely so with a visual artist. You put down form and color. And as you work with form and color, it begins to demand different things.
The forms and the colors
themselves make a demand.
Start to make a demand.
Because I have visualized and felt what I hoped this piece would become, and in looking at it, I could see it wasn't going to become that if I didn't make another color or another shape to interact with whatever was there.
So that's...
Or another texture. I'm big on textures.
Right. Well, how does your knowledge of what these media can and cannot do affect what you do?
Well, it's an acquired thing through experience of handling different paints, but as you know, I use media that...
You love mixed media, which was one of my questions, is how did you get into that?
And because I wanted more than flat paint could give me. To me.
And is that what led you to burlap and sand?
Sand and pieces from the earth itself, as some of the pieces are. And to collecting all kinds of papers and making them and using them. And because to me, that's a part of being creative, is being free to try something that hasn't been done or that is considered not done, shall we say.
Mm-hmm. Well, that leads me to a rather interesting question. What do you think creativity is?
Well, it's giving yourself the freedom, allowing yourself the freedom to look at things with a fresh eye. Now, I'm speaking of the visual artist.
Right. From your point of view as a visual artist.
I cannot say for the musician what sounds he hears in his head.
No, but from your experience.
From my experience, it is allowing yourself to think freely, to reach out and try things. And you may discard them. You may try 10 things before one thing works for you. But you have a freedom of choice when you're creative. You are not bound by the rigid rules of academia.
Okay, so...
And I use that as the French use that.
Right,
that
so...
I'm not...
So exploration is a part of creativity?
Yes, very much so.
Giving yourself permission to explore, to try things.
Yes.
It's a way of, for the visual artist, it's a way of seeing.
Of seeing. It's a new way of looking at an old, old subject.
Huh. And then trying to transpose the nonverbal image that comes into your mind, the picture, through your knowledge of technique and medium and...
Through your experience with handling your medium, different mediums, whatever. Now, I, as you know, I've taught.
Yes.
And one of the most difficult things that I have found to do is to get a student to break free of blue skies, red barns, and green grass.
So, one of the most difficult things to teach, then, is this concept of seeing with a different eye, with an eye that...
Well, they may see what I do, and they see it, but when they sit down in their whole background of art, since they were probably in kindergarten or first grade, somebody gave them a pattern. And unfortunately, that's deadly for creativity. If all that child sees or hears through school, through all of his schooling, is from some teacher, someone in authority, that it must look this way.
Uh-huh.
That is the most difficult thing to break through for a teacher. Once you do it, they are so happy with slinging paint, it is amazing.
So what do you think were, this leads me to a two-pronged question. One is, what do you think were the factors in your own background that contributed to your growth as an artist?
Well, you knew your grandmother and grandfather.
Yes.
And where I was concerned, I could do these things, and they never criticized. They never said, if I did it, that was fine.
But you didn't have a lot of materials to work with.
No, I had, like I said, the clay from the hills, and at first, pencils, color crayons. I remember a product map I did for the teacher in fourth grade, of products produced in areas of the USA. And mine was, looking back on it now, was a sophisticated way of showing it, because I colored the USA, and then in different colors I drew and painted these color crayons, these wheats and corns and whatever, cottons, whatever it was. And of course, she tried to crush me, but because she looked at it and she said, "You must have had some help with this." So I let it go.
It didn't crush you, though.
No, no. There is something, if you're sure about, and I wasn't sure about a lot of things, but whenever I did something that with my colors or my shapes, I was sure. Don't ask me why, because I had nobody to tell me at home that it wasn't right, because they were limited in their knowledge, but they did acquire art books for me, and this was Depression years, and they didn't have the money to spare. My mother ordered French pastels from Dallas that were absolutely, they were four trays. They cost $1,000 to $1,200 today.
Huh.
And I used them up until the fire when they burned.
They lasted all those years.
Oh, there were so many of them. Any color you would want, any hue. They were so creamy and soft and wonderful to work with. Now you buy pastels, they've got hard spots in them. It's not the same.
These were very special.
Very special.
And they burned in the fire.
Oh yeah. Oh. I don't know what she paid for them. My daddy had a fit because he thought, oh, we can't spare that much money, but didn't bother her. She spent it anyway.
But that was a way of her nurturing your gift.
Right.
She saw it as a gift,
yes,
I'm sure.
And she gave me what she could. And that's what I did. I used house paint.
Are those the pastels you did that piece that I had rescued from their home and had reframed?
All of my pastels are done with those pastels.
Wonderful material.
Oh, yes. They last forever unless their glass is off and they become scratched. But pastel is a very enduring art form, as long as it isn't wet or, I mean,
as long as it's cared for.
Cared for properly. Mm-hmm. It doesn't crack like the old master's oil paints have because of different changes in climate.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just wonderful. Now the acrylics we use today are fairly durable. I like them. Yeah, that's why I've switched.
You changed from oils to acrylics.
Yes.
And is that because the medium itself was...
The medium itself was plastic as oils, and you can move it around. It dries faster, which to me, is not a problem. It can be for some people, but it is not a problem for me. I don't mind it drying fast. If I don't like what happened, I can paint over it.
I see.
In a hurry.
So that's how you use, that's how you compensate for that factor, is that you just, if you don't like it, you revise it by painting over it.
You change it.
Right.
They're very adaptable and very durable. Very.
So the other part of my question has to do with this feeling from inside, and has to do with you have alluded to this at different times in different ways of how you feel about your work. And we've been talking about what that means in terms of value. It seems to me like there's two ways to value a work. It's how the intrinsically, it's the artist value they place for themselves. And then there's...
Are you speaking of dollars?
Well, that seems to be an extrinsic value. That seems to be something that's put...
That's put on.
That's
by
put
somebody
on
else.
It. Yes. Even though if you put your own price on your work, it's still...
That's not...
It's important. Still from the outside.
Right. It's not a part of the work.
So what I... Right. That's what I'm trying to get to, is the difference between the value that comes from the inside and the value that's from the outside.
Well, unless you can value your work, nobody else is going to value it. But the beginning artist has a tendency, monetarily, to put a very high price on that work because he's ignorant, or she. There is, of how other artists have started and grown. And they're in the process of growing, but they decide that finished piece is worth $18,000, which it never will do, because it's maybe good, it may be bad, it's their art and they value it. And that is important. If they will listen and grow, that's fine.
And how do you attach that inner value? I mean, where...
I don't know where it comes from. I have said before, I don't know. The world is always ready to knock you down. As a child, doing something different with their color crayons or with whatever they're doing, they're very vulnerable.
Uh-huh.
Very vulnerable. Now, to keep from being destroyed, or keep from trying to become more creative, sometimes they quit because there's too much opposition to something different from what that teacher knows.
But
or
you
that
didn't
person.
Quit. You didn't quit.
No, I didn't quit. But I can't tell you why I didn't quit.
Yeah.
That's what you want to know.
Why did you keep painting and drawing no matter what? You've done it all your life.
Because that's what I wanted to do. That was a part of me, separate from everybody else that I knew at the time of growing up. I was the only one that I knew that did that. And that was me.
And it was all right with you that you were the only one that did it.
It was fine with me. Now, where it came to dating boys, I wasn't ready. And yet, I thought, gee, I'd like to be popular. How does she get that boy to like her? What does she do? But it wasn't... I guess I didn't want to badly enough to drop everything I was doing and boy chase. Mm-hmm. You know, these are teen things, but they're growing things.
Mm-hmm. You You did a lot of drawing and working with your pastels.
I did. In those teenage years.
I
did. I truly did. And I was just as happy as I could be. I just didn't have any better sense. I don't know.
And you didn't go to art school, though?
No. I had no formal training till I went to college. And I wanted to go to St. Louis, to the Art Institute there. But Mother and Daddy couldn't afford to send me. And Mother said I would have tried for a work and a scholarship. But, oh, it was probably more than that. They probably didn't want me that far from home. I don't know. But anyway, I went because I said, I will take art wherever I can go. And I did. Mm-hmm. So the first college I went to only offered an art minor. But I took it. I double minored. And I had a major. And I minored in art. And I wanted to take figure drawing. They didn't offer figure drawing, per se, in that little college. But could I have gotten into pre-med? They were drawing muscles and arms and things, and that's what I really wanted to do. And I begged and begged to go into pre-med class, that class. And he thought that being the only woman, girl, in that class would, he says, I think the boys will just be a little rough on you. I didn't think they would be, but he didn't let me take it.
The professor wouldn't give you permission?
No, he was sweet as he could be, but he said, I just don't think I should subject you to that raucous male humor that you're going to get. He was being protective.
Mm-hmm. So you didn't get to do figure drawing then?
No, but I did a lot later. Mm-hmm. So anyway, it was...
You did have formal training as an adult later on.
Oh, yes. For a while, there was the war. And, of course, I married your father. And we went from base to base. And he flew, and I stayed with the other gals. And
always drawing.
And we went in Delaware. I didn't do any. That was the first time we were married in 43, and I joined him in 44 in Newcastle, Delaware, and he was flying all over the world. And that was not conducive to anything other than filling in time and waiting for them to come home in one piece. But we were transferred then to Hamilton Field in San Francisco, and I did some things in pastels, had my pastels, for Gumps, which is the thing, you know, so.
You did what?
I did some figures of some, I believe, if I vaguely remember, they were Polynesian, they were dark, a lovely woman, and a very strong, muscular man in pastels with warm skin tones. And they were done for Gumps, which is...
What does Gumps mean?
Well,
what do you
Gumps
mean?
Was the... Oops. If you had a lot of money and you were decorating, you would go to Gumps. They had exotic...
It was a store.
A store. It was the store for fine things.
I see.
Fine things.
And they bought these pieces that you did?
I don't remember how they acquired them, whether they acquired them for resale or somebody in Gumps acquired. I really don't remember. I was rather pregnant at the time. And
with me?
Yeah, yes. And then... there was the transfer, and your dad, I couldn't go, and I had to go by train, and oh, here I am. Pregnant. So those are busy years.
So you have these two pieces that are somewhere?
I don't have them, I don't know where they are.
I mean, that somebody in this store, acquired.
Yeah, I don't know, and it might have been an insurance man. He was very much taken with them. But that was, I did them, and I was happy with them, and that for me was enough. And whatever, whoever else liked them, I was glad they liked them. But I was through with them. That was it. I'm through.
So there's a certain value that you have for the work as you're doing it, when it's finished, and you don't have a trouble letting go of it when it's finished.
Not really. I may own a piece or two, have a certain thing that I like that I'll hang on to a piece, you know. But most of the time I know I can do another one. Or I'm involved in other pieces, so I'm happy if people like it, want to buy it. I let it go.
Mm-hmm.
And give it my blessing and tell them to take good care of it.
Is there a struggle between that inner value and the outer value of putting the price on it?
Oh yes, always. Always.
Because it seems to me problematic sometimes to match.
It's
the outer and the inner value, yeah. So that you feel.
Well, the inner value is not a value that's monetary at all.
Exactly.
Not at all.
Exactly.
It is a value of doing the work. If it's a commission and you've pleased the people, then you're glad. But the monetary value is something apart. And as you know, in the art world, it is just full of people who are more or less ready, if they are handling an artist, so that their gallery or their place will make more money to build that art up. And only time will tell if it's going to last.
Uh-huh.
It has to stand the test of time.
Time. Mm.
Because, you know, if you read art history at all, through the passage of time, the good pieces have sifted through and become much more valuable monetarily than they ever were. But when the artist completed it, his value was there.
Mm-hmm. The way the artist
felt about
what
he was doing.
Or what
yeah,
she
his
or he was
value
doing.
Was there. It had mm-hmm. nothing to do with money.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing.
Mm-hmm. And how do you think that inner value, that aspect of play, of having your own value for a piece, how do you think that interacts with this issue of trusting yourself, of having confidence in yourself?
Well, I think I said before, unless you have some confidence in yourself, you won't put a value on it. You won't have a value. You're waiting for somebody else to tell you its value.
Which brings us back to some of the things you've observed as a teacher.
Yes.
Of students, whatever their age, saying to the teacher, is it good?
Right.
And how do you help them to learn the answer to that question from within?
Well, you don't know whether you have reached the within or not.
But I mean, so that they don't just always come and say, is it good? That they're able to say, this is good. I like this piece.
Oh, after a year with me, they know. They know.
And how do you bring that about?
Because when they're working on a piece, and we have our critiques, and I'm usually very gentle with it because they have put themselves into that piece of work. And I would not want to be destructive, but I want to be constructive. So I will point out to them areas that really sing, that really say what they want to say. And then maybe they've even muddied their paint. And then we'll go to that area and we'll compare it, and they learn. They learn.
Mm-hmm. And learn through that dialoguing.
Mm-hmm.
And
I take them to art shows.
And talk about
mm-hmm.
the different yes. aspects
I
of pieces.
I expose them to things.
Mm-hmm.
To things. To other people's work. And they become quite confident that they're good art critics.
So
it's funny.
So
it's cute.
So it's a way, coming back, to, then it's a way of seeing. You're helping to
That's
develop
right.
a way of seeing.
Of seeing and feeling, because they try to get what that artist is about, which involves feeling what he said and seeing how he expressed it.
Mm-hmm. Now, of course, it could be a woman artist
well
as a man.
I can't be bothered. Is worrying whether I say he, she, or it. It doesn't matter. I'm talking about an artist, and they have no gender. No. Only when they quit painting do they revert to gender or creating. Then they can have their own private life and do what they please.
Great. Well, I think we're going to stop for today.
All right.
I
have talked a lot.
I
didn't know I could talk this much.
It's been a lot of fun.
Thank you.
And I've really enjoyed it.
Good.
And I'd like you to just sit right here, and I will fade out.
Oh, do fade properly. One never knows whether one is being useful or not.
You have been very useful.
Good.
We are back with Margarette Lawson, artist, and she is standing now in front of a piece that she did as a commission. Tell us about this piece, Margarette.
Well, as you know, this is realistic realism that I'm not overly fond of doing, but these were dear friends, and they collected rhinos. Or they do collect rhinos, and she wanted a piece of my art and wanted it to be recognizable rhinos. So she kept sending me, she lives in Sacramento, she kept sending me tons and tons of photos with cute lips, her expression that these rhinos had, and finally I did a composite and got a drawing, a composition that satisfied me with a rhino from here, a baby from here, this, that, and the other. And I researched and found these are black rhinos. And I researched and found their habitat, what it looked like. And I put them in what I conceived as an artist their habitat might look like.
And what are some of the issues that come up for you as an artist working with a piece that is a commission piece versus your own original creation?
Well, the big difference is you're doing what they want, using materials that please you, because you have to have that. And That's essentially the difference, because when you're free to do when you're doing your own thing, you're only going after your feelings.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted their feelings, but at the same time, I did use a collage technique. I do have different surfaces and different papers, which gives the roughness of the rhino. Certainly their skin is not Avon.
Right.
It's it's heavy.
Point out where you've put some of the collage papers into the piece.
Oh, it's all collage. It's all over.
The grass, the sky, everything?
Everything. Oh, I did paint little sketches of grass in, rather than put little strips of paper. That's picky, but
the figures are all collaged.
They're all collaged. The water's collaged. The babies, mm-hmm. The background, the sky. It's paper.
Mm-hmm. And you drew the figures in, sketched them in with paint?
I sketched them in with, I don't remember whether it was charcoal or, uh-huh. or paint. It may have been paint. And did the composition.
Right.
And then went from there.
I see.
I didn't worry about a drawing. Except to get what I was after was the feeling of real force in these animals, real right. heaviness, even brutishness. They're very brutal, but they're not toward their babies.
Right.
They're extremely caring and tender. And I wanted the difference between this animal, when it really is just an animal, and the animal with a baby.
I see. Thank you. This is a piece that Margaret did as a part of her December show that was in the San Bernardino County Museum of Art. Margaret, would you like to read your haiku title of this piece?
The wall of hatred crumbled, but not soon enough to stop the bleeding.
And lovely.
I was inspired to do this by the wall, the tearing down of the Berlin Wall. I know this is done quite a bit after, but all the time it was happening, I was so caught up in the news that I didn't really have any particular desire to do anything. I just listened. And then all of a sudden one day I thought, I need to do the crumbling wall with people trying and blood on it and the wire, barbed wire on top. And that's real barbed wire. I went down and found a piece. They couldn't believe I wanted some barbed wire for a painting. But they let me have it for a dollar, I think, something. And brought it home, and I had the painting essentially done. I had the wall, it's highly textured. There's modeling compound and sand and different papers, and I made them at different times and then tore the pieces so that they fit together in an odd sort of way, like bricks would that were crumbling, and I had it essentially done, except I needed my barbed wire on there, and it's on a masonite, and I called Handyman John, who is my dear roommate and framer.
And husband.
And husband and helper, and he helped me position the barbed wire as I wanted it and secured it through to the back because his hands were stronger than mine and he could twist the wires that hold it, and it's very secure. And then I added the paint to the barbed wire, or the symbolism that it would tear and make the blood flow as people tried to get over it. And those are not actually figures, although they can read as figures. They're symbolism of all of the trials that people went through to get past that wall. And that's a piece that I make you. It's pretty personal.
Good. We're now standing in front of another piece that comes from the December show referred to earlier. The name of that show was Earth Places Explored, inner visions. And Margaret, tell us about the piece that you're standing in front of. You read your haiku title and show us the sketch that you had to begin it.
Gray day on gray beach, past broken down cottages. One had a red door. This is the sketch, or the collage sketch type that I made before I began the bigger piece.
Okay, keep and holding it up so I can.
You hold it?
I want to zoom in on it. There we go. You can tell us about what you did the sketch with.
Paper, just pieces of paper and paint. If I put colored pieces of paper down if they were the wrong color, I painted it. And it's rough. You can feel the edges of the paper. But then
you went to this, the large piece.
Yes. And I worked it out by using different textures, different papers. Here's one paper. Here's another paper. Here is a piece of cloth that's coated with resin, lightly coated with resin, and then painted, and to get that funny gray and feel of chopped up.
In an earlier conversation, you said that red doors were important. Why did you say that?
Red doors are red in some cultures.
Uh-huh.
It's symbolism of life.
Uh-huh.
And some cultures, their doors or arches are red.
Right.
Always.
And what does a red door mean to you?
Come in.
So it's an...
There's happiness here.
I see.
Come in.
In China, I think red is for good luck.
Well, yes.
So a red door...
And this one was the door still hung, a little crooked. Now this is all from the head because there was no red door on this particular beach, but there should have been. So I...
In other words, you imagined it.
Oh, sure, because you can't, you don't want to sit and copy what you see. You want the feel of these cottages that need some repair. The salt air and the sun can do great damage to wood.
Right.
So, I just...
And how large is this piece?
It's 4 feet by 5 feet.
And so you went from your tiny little sketch...
From this to that, with no in between.
Right. Great.
This piece is a piece that grew. I had made the form, the resin form, and done the shapes. And I had started working on it with the paint, and it wasn't happening. And so I put it aside and waited for some more time to think about it. And as I thought about it, I knew that it was actually a piece of earth, a piece of my environment down there at the studio. So I went out one day on an inspiration and looked under the shrubs and the trees that are around the studio and picked up dried materials. And I thought, that's perfect. That gives the idea of what I want. So I did the piece, added some liquid resin, and put in the material. Because being organic, would disintegrate if they were not covered with a resin. So I did lightly, and then I let that cure. It's called curing. And again began to work on the colors and how I felt as the roots took shape and the parts of the earth, the lights and the darks, began to grow. And I worked on it for a period of quite some time because I would get picky, so I'd put it aside and then go back. And one day I couldn't work on it, but I thought, this has to be mounted. So I got the background, the mounting. I textured it, I painted it, I worked out the little map-like sections and put it against it, and it worked. And that, because I did that, I was able then to put the finish touches on the painting. And I used, after it was all cured again and dry, I put glue and weights and weighted it to its support, to this, and then we framed it and it was done.
And how did you know when it was done? What was it that said to you, this is finished?
Well, I looked at it and I couldn't think of anything else it could say.
I see.
The painting itself has to speak.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't see where I could add
or
another thing.
Or take away?
I didn't need to take anything away.
Uh-huh.
Because it was there.
Uh-huh.
And when it's there, through experience and listening to yourself and letting the painting talk, you learn to walk away and say it's done.
Uh-huh. And that takes time and experience.
Time, experience, and a trust in the painting itself.
Uh-huh. So that the painting, the product, the painting itself is a part of the process.
Yes, it certainly is.
I see.
If you do not listen to what it's telling you, it just doesn't go anywhere.
I see. Thank you, Margaret.
You're welcome.
We're going to walk around now in the house and look at pieces that come from different periods of Margaret's painting and artistic life. The first one I'm going to focus on is a painting of her father, my grandfather. It's a small little portrait. Tell us about it, Margaret.
Well, he sat for me one day, and I could get him. And because he was a very dignified, warm, but he was a true gentleman. And he had served in the First World War. And so I thought, I had this photograph of him saluting at this, I don't know, he'd come home on leave or something, and they had made a photograph of him in his World War I uniform, and he was saluting. So I put that in as though he were thinking of a young man who had gone off to France to serve his country.
What a wonderful story, and there it is, all in the painting. Thank you. Okay, we're moving through the house now, and we're going back in time as we move through the house. We are going to go back to when Margaret was a small girl. She's going to stand next to this portrait of herself when she was quite young, which she did.
I was five.
With her pastels.
Yes.
That she talked about earlier, right, Margaret?
Right.
Uh-huh.
That wonderful magic box of
yes.
pastels. And I had seen this photograph of myself, and Mother had said that they had taken me to the studio, to the photographer's studio, to have my pictures made. And
mm-hmm.
I was not happy about that. It was very dull and I didn't want to go. And so the photographer took it anyway in one of my less than happy mood. And he did get some better ones, but this one appealed to me, because as a child, you hate to sit. And so I took it and I used it for a portrait of me at 5.
It's wonderful.
And I was, what? Little.
How old were you when you did the portrait?
I really don't know.
In your teens?
Early teens.
Or maybe 13, 14?
Maybe
12.
I don't know.
Uh-huh.
Honestly, because I didn't know to date my work.
Right.
I just did it.
Right. And it was saved because it was in your mother's house.
Oh, yeah. The things that are saved from my early work were with mother.
Uh-huh.
Otherwise, when the studio burned, I lost books and work and stuff.
Sketchbooks from years.
Sketches, original drawings, all sorts.
And paintings. I can remember some paintings.
Yeah, paintings.
Went.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. But.
Well, we're lucky to have what we have.
Sure.
And now we're going now. Now we're going to look at a piece that is over Margaret and John's bed, which was done much later.
Much later.
This is about sometime in the 70s, isn't it? Maybe 80s? Down, it was the Del Rosa studio, right?
Yes, it might have been 79.
Uh-huh. That's what I would have guessed.
Was
this a model, or?
Well, I won't tell you how I got the body, but that's okay.
Why?
Well, I had to use a mirror.
Oh my goodness, so in a way this is a self-portrait
well,
too?
Well, maybe a wishful self-portrait.
A wishful self-portrait. Oh, this is wonderful. I didn't know this story about this painting.
Yeah, I had to have a body. And
I've always loved it.
I couldn't ask any of my students to pose. They wouldn't have done it. And of course, at the time, we had several kittens and cats and they were constantly on my bed, and that's where they are, with one of my grandmother's old quilts.
And then
the hat's a fabrication.
The hat, right, and the face, that's not your face.
Not really.
No, you've changed it. So what you did was you took a basic shape and then created
I glamorized it. I Hollywoodized it. Legitimate.
Of course, it's wonderful.
It's okay.
It's wonderful.
I wanted to make a painting and I didn't mind.
It's wonderful.
It was not accurate.
This is one of my personal favorites of her representational pieces. It's simply called The Cranes, I believe.
It's The Crane.
The Crane.
He's the big blue heron.
And it's in. What's the medium that you use in this one?
This is chalk and on dark paper, on black paper.
Chalk on dark paper, and that's the reflection of the crane in the water down there.
Yeah.
And then the crane himself.
He was fun to do.
Yes.
He was so elegant.
Now, did you look at a picture, or did you just do it from your head?
There was a snapshot I found, I've forgotten where, of cranes,
uh-huh.
A bunch of, it was blue herons, and in among them was this fella.
Uh-huh.
So I segregated him and put him, used him.
You pulled him out of the general snapshot.
Of the group.
Right.
I thought he was the most elegant looking. The others were busy with their heads in the water and
right.
Getting fish and doing all sorts of things. But
doing crane things. And this was one of your early rosin pieces?
Yes, very early.
And you were experimenting with the medium with this?
Yes, how what it would do and how far I could take it.
So the medium itself began to teach you, is that correct?
That is correct.
Tell us what you learned from working here.
Oh, it was exciting. I learned that that my idea would work.
Uh-huh.
That the medium of the resin was very compatible with the
paint.
Right. And that you could, within limits, they each had their limit of setting up, you could move it and shape it and form it.
Does this piece have a title?
I think I called it The Mountain.
Uh-huh.
Sometimes I didn't bother with titles.
Uh-huh. We're going to try anyway because it's a different technique.
It's watercolor.
It's watercolor, but she uses saran wrap somehow or another in this process.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about what you do with the watercolor.
Oh, it's a lot of fun.
Saran wrap.
Put your colors. You wet your paper, make sure it's not wet, but damp, and you put your colors in, float them on, throw them on, do whatever you want to with them.
Trade sides.
And you crumple your saran wrap and put it on there, and you leave it for long enough to set some shapes, when you pull it up, then you have whatever you have.
I see, and so the discovery is part of the process.
Oh yes, it's fun.
And now we're traveling back in time again because we're going to come upon a very early piece, another one of the pieces done with the
pastels.
And you looked at a book.
Yep, my first art book. I don't know. I guess it burned.
And you did her.
It was an incredible book.
And this is also done with the magical box of pastels, right?
Right. I was teaching myself about color.
Teaching yourself about color.
Mm-hmm. So I had to use, fortunately, they bought me the book, and I could certainly use good artists to learn.
Yeah, that's good.
This is Pinky,
uh-huh.
Gainsborough's Pinky.
And this was in the book also?
In the book.
And you were about what when you did these? 13?
I was in my teens, 14, 15. I was in high school. Let's
okay.
Put it that way.
All right.
And just having a wonderful time with that book and my pastels. And of course, when I came to California and saw the actual Pinky, I thought, well, you didn't do too bad a job, kid.
No, you didn't. There she is.
It's a beautiful.
And you learned so much from doing this kind of work.
Yes, what colors would do one against the other and the blending.
And now Pinky's companion is Blue Boy.
Mm-hmm.
Done the same time period, right?
Sure. Once I did him or her, and I don't remember which came first, the other one had to follow.
So there's something to be said for a developing artist replicating the masters.
Sure.
That there's a time of learning and training that can go on with that contest.
I think so. I think it's rather important.
Well, and we're going to be looking at a piece that Margaret did that was part of her test for UC Davis to see if she was ready for a master's program in painting. Margaret, you want to step in and tell us about this piece, please?
Well, it's very interesting. I shall keep this piece.
Uh-huh.
The day I had taken art history and other courses they had recommended, of course, to pick up units that I didn't have from my first degree. And then the day that the students
were to come to the studio at 8 o'clock for our test.
Uh-huh.
And they had set up a still life, and we were to do that day 3 paintings. The first was a traditional still life.
Right.
The second was an abstracted still life, and the third was non-objective. And this is the non-objective that came at the end or at the latter part of that day's work. And that's when I entered the master's program.
And you painted these 3 paintings in one day?
Yes.
Were they all this large?
The others were about 24 by 30.
Huh.
I guess that's not, that is small, but it certainly is large. But when it came time to do the non-objective, I had my canvas ready and I took off.
It's a wonderful piece.
Well, I still have, I think, somewhere the, no, I probably so. The other two still life paintings? The abstracted still life and the representational still life. Mm-hmm. I think they sold. I thought I had them. I think so. Can't remember. Anyway.
And I'm sure you didn't keep track of who bought them.
Well, no. I wasn't worried about history. Just on to the next painting.
Uh huh.
Yeah.
Well, this is a wonderful piece, and
there's a lot of joy in it. We had a wonderful day, and some didn't make it because they couldn't break through.
Uh huh. And they were looking for that. They were looking
for
you to have the technique to be
right. To break through.
Right. They wanted to see technique in the traditional, but
sure. If you could handle paint.
We are back with Margarette Lawson, artist, and she is standing now in front of a piece that she did as a commission. Tell us about this piece, Margarette.
Well, as you know, this is realistic realism that I'm not overly fond of doing, but these were dear friends, and they collected rhinos. They do collect rhinos, and she wanted a piece of my art and wanted it to be recognizable rhino. So she kept sending me, she lives in Sacramento, she kept sending me tons and tons of photos with cute lips, her expression that these rhinos had, and finally I did a composite and got a drawing, a composition that satisfied me with a rhino from here, a baby from here, this, that, and the other. And I researched and found these are black rhinos. And I researched and found their habitat, what it looked like. And I put them in what I conceived as an artist their habitat might look like.
And what are some of the issues that come up for you as an artist working with a piece that is a commission piece versus your own original creation?
Well, the big difference is you're doing what they want, using materials that please you, because you have to have that. And That's essentially the difference, because when you're free to do when you're doing your own thing, you're only going after your feelings.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted their feelings, but at the same time, I did use a collage technique. I do have different surfaces and different papers, which gives the roughness of the rhino. Certainly their skin is not Avon.
Right.
It's
it's heavy.
Point out where you've put some of the collage papers into the piece.
Oh, it's all collage. It's all over.
The grass, the sky, everything?
Everything. Oh, I did paint little sketches of grass in, rather than put little strips of paper. That's picky, but...
But the figures are all collaged.
They're all collaged. The water's collage. The babies, mm-hmm. the background, the sky, it's paper.
Mm-hmm. And you drew the figures in, sketched them in with paint?
I sketched them in with, I don't remember whether it was charcoal or, uh-huh. or paint. It may have been paint. And did the composition.
Right.
And then went from there.
I see.
I didn't worry about a drawing, except to get what I was after was that the feeling of real force in these animals, real right. heaviness, even brutishness. They're very brutal, but they're not toward their babies.
Right.
They're extremely caring and tender, and I wanted the difference between this animal, when it really is just an animal, and the animal with a baby.
I see. Thank you.
To get it, and I've sent her photos of it. That's why there's a frame on it. She was pleased with it, and it will be shipped.
We're going to pause for a moment here. This is a piece that Margaret did as a part of her December show that was in the San Bernardino County Museum of Art. Margaret, would you like to read your haiku title of this piece?
The wall of hatred crumbled, but not soon enough to stop the bleeding.
And lovely.
I was inspired to do this by the wall. Tearing down the Berlin Wall. I know this is done quite a bit after, but all the time it was happening, I was so caught up in the news that I didn't really have any particular desire to do anything. I just listened. And then all of a sudden one day I thought, I need to do the crumbling wall with people trying and blood on it and the wire, barbed wire on top. And that's real barbed wire. I went down and found a piece. They couldn't believe I wanted some barbed wire for a painting. But they let me have it for a dollar, I think, something, and brought it home, and I had the painting essentially done. I had the wall. It's highly textured. There's modeling compound and sand and different papers, and I made them at different times and then tore the pieces so that they fit together in an odd sort of way, like bricks would that were crumbling. And I had it essentially done, except I needed my barbed wire on there. And it's on a masonite. And I called Handyman John, who is my dear roommate and framer.
And husband.
And husband and helper. And he helped me position the barbed wire as I wanted it, and secured it through to the back, because his hands were stronger than mine and he could twist the wires that hold it, and it's very secure. And then I added the paint to the barbed wire, or the symbolism that it would tear and make the blood flow as people tried to get over it. And those are not actually figures, although they can read as figures. They're symbolism of all of the of the trials that people went through to get past that wall. And that's a piece that I make you. It's pretty personal.
Good. We're now standing in front of another piece that comes from the December show referred to earlier. The name of that show was Earth Places Explored, Inner Visions. And Margaret, tell us about the piece that you're standing in front of. You read your haiku title and show us the sketch that you had to begin it.
Gray day on gray beach. Past broken down cottages, one had a red door. This is the sketch, or the collage sketch type that I made before I began the bigger piece.
Okay, keep holding it up so I can.
You would hold it?
I want to zoom in on it. There we go. And you can tell us about what you did the sketch with.
Paper, just pieces of paper and paint. If I put colored pieces of paper down, if they were the wrong color, I'd paint it. And it's rough. You can feel the edges of the paper. But then
you went to this, the large piece.
Yes. And I worked it out by using different textures, different papers. Here's one paper, another paper. Here is a piece of cloth that's coated with a resin, lightly coated with resin, and then painted, and to get that funny gray and feel of chopped upness.
In an earlier conversation, you said that red doors were important. Why did you say that?
Red doors are red in some cultures.
Uh-huh.
A symbolism of life.
Uh-huh.
And some cultures, their doors or arches are red.
Right.
Always.
And what does a red door mean to you?
Come in.
So it's an
there's happiness. Here.
I see.
Come in.
In China, I think red is for good luck.
Well, yes.
So a red door.
And this one was, the door still hung, a little crooked. Now this is all from the head because there was no red door on this particular beach, but there should have been. So
in other words, you imagined it.
Oh, sure. Because you can't.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to sit and copy what you see. You want the feel of these cottages that need some repairs. The salt air and the sun can do great damage to wood.
Right.
So, I just...
And how large is this piece?
It's 4 feet by 5 feet.
And so you went from your tiny little sketch...
From this to that. With no in between.
Right. Great. This is another piece with Margaret Lawson again. And we are filming our second conversation with Margaret. We're going to begin at a piece which was part of her show of Earth Places Revisited. And here we go.
This piece is a piece that grew. I had made the form, the resin form, and done the shapes, and I had started working on it with the paint, and it wasn't happening. And so I put it aside and waited for some more time to think about it. And as I thought about it, I knew that it was actually a piece of earth, a piece of my environment down there at the studio. So I went out one day on an inspiration and looked under the shrubs and the trees that are around the studio and picked up dried materials. And I thought, that's perfect. That gives the idea of what I want. So I did the piece, added some liquid resin, and put in the materials, because they would, being organic, would disintegrate if they were not covered with a resin. So I did lightly, and then I let that cure. It's called curing. And again began to work on the colors and how I felt as the roots took shape and the parts of the earth, the lights and the darks, began to grow. And I worked on it for a period of quite some time because I would get picky, so I'd put it aside and then go back. And one day I couldn't work on it, but I thought, this has to be mounted. So I got the background, the mounting. I textured it, I painted it, I worked out the little map-like sections and put it against it, and it worked. And that, because I did that, I was able then to put finish touches on the painting. And I used, after it was all cured again and dry, I put glue and weights and weighted it to its support, to this, and then we framed it and it was done.
And how did you know when it was done? What was it that said to you, this is finished?
Well, I looked at it and I couldn't think of anything else it could say.
I see.
The painting itself has to speak.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't see where I could add
or
another thing.
Or take away?
I didn't need to take anything away,
uh-huh,
because it was there.
Uh-huh.
And when it's there, through experience and listening to yourself and letting the painting talk, you learn to walk away and say it's done.
Uh-huh. And that takes time and experience.
Time, experience, and a trust in the painting itself.
Uh-huh. So that the product itself is a part of the process.
Yes, it certainly is.
I see.
If you do not listen to what it's telling you, it just doesn't go anywhere.
I see. Thank you, Margaret.
You're welcome.
We're going to walk around now in the house and look at pieces that come from different periods of Margaret's painting and artistic life. The first one I'm going to focus on is a painting of her father, my grandfather. It's a small little portrait. Tell us about it, Margaret.
Well, he sat for me one day, and I could get him, and because he was a very dignified, warm, but he was a true gentleman, and he had served in the First World War, and so I thought, I had this photograph of him saluting at the, I don't know, he'd come home on leave or something, and they had made a photograph of him in his World War I uniform, and he was saluting. So I put that in as though he were thinking of a young man who had gone off to France to serve his country.
What a wonderful story, and there it is, all in the painting. Thank you. Okay, we're moving through the house now, and we're going back in time as we move through the house. We are going to go back to when Margaret was a small girl, and she's going to stand in front of a self-portrait.
Now,
No. I checked it.
It's fine. Okay.
Just get over there.
Oh, okay.
She's going to stand next to this portrait of herself when she was quite young, which she did.
I was five. And
with her pastels.
Yes.
That she talked about earlier, right, Margaret?
Right. Uh-huh. That wonderful magic box of pastels. And I had seen this photograph of myself, and Mother had said that they had taken me to the studio, to the photographer's studio, to have my pictures made, and I was not happy about that. It was very dull, and I didn't want to go. And so the photographer took it anyway, in one of my less than happy moods, and he did get some better ones, but this one appealed to me, because as a child, you hate to sit. And so I took it, and I used it for a portrait of me at five.
It's wonderful.
And I was, what? A little.
How 13. Old were you when you did the portrait?
I really don't know.
In your teens?
Early teens.
Or maybe 13,
maybe
14.
12.
Maybe 12.
I don't know.
Uh-huh.
Honestly, because I didn't know to date my work.
Right.
I just did it.
Right. And it was saved because it was in your mother's house.
Oh, yeah. The things that are saved from my early work were with Mother.
Uh-huh.
Otherwise, when the studio burned, I lost books and work and everything, you know, stuff.
Sketchbooks from years.
Sketches, original drawings, all sorts.
And paintings. I can remember some paintings.
Yeah, paintings.
Went.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Some things I don't.
Well, we're lucky to have what we have.
Sure.
And now we're going now.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're going to look at a piece that is over Margaret and John's bed, which was done much later.
Much later.
This is about sometime in the 70s, isn't it? Maybe 80s? Down, it was the Del Rosa studio, right?
Yes. Might have been 79.
Uh-huh. That's what I would have guessed.
And
was this a model, or?
Well, I won't tell you how I got the body, but that's okay.
Why?
Well, I had to use a mirror.
Oh my goodness, so there's a way this is a self-portrait too?
Maybe a wishful self-portrait.
A wishful self-portrait. Oh, this is wonderful. I didn't know this story about this painting.
Yeah, I had to have a body. And
I've always loved it.
I couldn't ask any of my students to pose. They wouldn't have done it. And, of course, at the time, we had several kittens and cats. And they were constantly on my bed. That's where they are.
Uh-huh.
With one of my grandmother's old quilts.
And then
the hat's a fabrication.
And the face. That's not your face.
Not really.
No. You've changed it. So what you did was you took a basic shape and then created
I glamorized it. I Hollywoodized it. That's legitimate.
Of course, it's wonderful.
It's okay.
It's wonderful.
I wanted to make a painting, and I didn't mind.
That's wonderful.
It was not accurate.
Now we're going to continue our walk. You want to open the door so we can get through, please? Oh, you want? Oh, we can do this one, right? Right. This is one of my personal favorites. of her representational pieces. It's simply called The Cranes, I believe.
It's The Crane.
The Crane.
He's the big blue heron.
And it's in, what's the medium that you use in this one?
This is chalk and on dark paper, on black paper.
Chalk on dark paper, and that's the reflection of the crane in the water down there.
Yeah.
And then the crane himself.
He was fun to do.
Yes.
He was so elegant.
Now, did you look at a picture, or did you just do it from your head?
There was a snapshot I found, I've forgotten where, of cranes,
uh-huh.
A bunch of it was blue herons, and in among them was this fella. So
uh-huh.
I segregated him and put him, used him.
You pulled him out of the general snapshot.
Of the group.
Right.
I thought he was the most elegant looking. The others were busy with their heads in the water and
right.
getting fish and doing all sorts of things. But
doing crane things.
Yep. To be a crane, you have to do a crane stuff.
Excuse me.
Okay.
We're continuing to walk through the house. And we're going to shoot a piece that she did that's a precursor, really, to the work
My
for Earth Places
Earth
Revisited.
Places.
And this was one of your early rosin pieces?
Yes, very early.
And you were experimenting with the medium with this?
Yes, how what it would do and how far I could take it.
So the medium itself began to teach you, is that correct?
That is correct.
Tell us what you learned from working here.
Oh, it was exciting. I learned that my idea would work.
Uh-huh.
That the medium of the resin was very compatible with the
paint.
Right. And that you could,
within
limits, they each had their limit of setting up, you could move it and shape it and form it.
Does this piece have a title?
I think I called it The Mountain.
Uh-huh.
Sometimes I didn't bother with titles.
Uh-huh. And then just above it, there's a piece that if you turn that one light on above you, I think, and I turn this one off, we might be able to get that one. Yeah, I think that'll be okay. We're going to try anyway because it's a different technique.
It's watercolor.
It's watercolor, but she uses saran wrap somehow or another in this process.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about what you do with the watercolor.
Oh, it's a lot of fun. You
saran wrap.
Put your colors, you wet your paper, make sure it's not wet, but damp, and you put your colors in, float them on, throw them on, do whatever you want to with them.
Trade sides.
And you crumple your saran wrap and put it on there, and
uh-huh.
you leave it for long enough to set some shapes,
uh-huh.
and when you pull it up, then you have whatever you have.
I see, and so the discovery is part of the process.
Oh yes, it's fun, and it's sometimes you get incredible effects.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes you get a bunch of stuff, you throw it away, or save it for a collage. So
it all works for something.
Yeah.
And now we're traveling back in time again because we're going to come upon, I think you're going to have to turn that light off for me.
Yeah.
We're going to come upon a very early piece, another one of the pieces done with the
Pastels.
And you looked at a book.
Yep, my first art book, I don't know, I guess it burned. It.
And you did her.
It was an incredible book.
And this is also done with a magical box of pastels, right?
Right. I was teaching myself about color.
Teaching yourself about color.
Mm-hmm. So I had to use, fortunately, they bought me the book, and I could certainly use good artists to learn. Otherwise, it would have not been done.
Could you turn that little light on now and see if any reflection comes from that one?
That should be it.
Yeah, that's good.
This is Pinky.
Uh-huh.
Gainsborough's Pinky.
And this was in the book also.
In the book.
And you were about what when you did these? 13?
I was in my teens. Uh-huh. 14, 15. I was in high school. Let's
okay.
Put it that way.
All right.
And just having a wonderful time with that book and my pastels. And of course, when I came to California and saw the actual Pinky, I thought, well, you didn't do too bad a job, kid.
No, you didn't. There she is.
It's a beautiful.
And you learned so much from doing
yes.
this kind of work.
Yes, what colors would do one against the other, and the blending and the.
Now we have to turn it back off. Try that one over there.
It might work. I think it'll go in. Good.
Yeah, that's good. And now, Pinky's companion is Blue Boy.
Mm-hmm.
Done the same time period, right?
Sure. Once I did him or her, and I don't remember which came first, the other one had to follow.
So there's something to be said for a developing artist replicating the masters.
Sure.
That there's a time of learning and training that can go on with that contest.
I think so. I think it's rather important.
Do me a favor, could you pick up
helps you gain respect.
It's on the patio, and we're going to be looking at a piece that Margaret did that was part of her test for UC Davis to see if she was ready for a master's program in painting. Margaret, you want to step in and tell us about this piece, please?
Well, it's very interesting. I shall keep this piece.
Uh-huh.
The day I had taken art history and other courses they had recommended, of course, to pick up units that I didn't have from my first degree. And then the day that the students were to come to the studio at 8:00 for our test.
Uh-huh.
And they had set up a still life, and we were to do that day 3 paintings. The first was a traditional still life.
Right.
The second was an abstracted still life. And the third was non-objective. And this is the non-objective that came at the end or at the latter part of that day's work. And that's when I entered the master's program.
And you painted these 3 paintings in one day?
Yes.
Were they all this large?
The others were about 24 by 30.
Huh.
I guess that's not, that is small, but it certainly is large. But when it came time to do the non-objective, I had my canvas ready and I took off.
It's a wonderful piece.
Well, I still have, I think, somewhere the,
still life paintings?
The abstracted still life and the representational still. Mm-hmm. I think they saw. I thought I had another. I think so. Can't remember. Anyway.
And I'm sure you didn't keep track of who bought them.
Well, no.
No.
On to the next painting.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Well, this is a wonderful piece. And
there's a lot of joy in it. We had a wonderful day. And some didn't make it.
Uh-huh.
Because they couldn't break through.
Uh-huh. And they were looking for that. They were looking
they
for
were
you
looking
to have the technique to be...
Right. To break through.
Right. They wanted to see technique in the traditional, but...
Sure. If you could handle paint in color.
Right.
And
who did you study with there?
Well, I studied with William Wiley.
Uh-huh.
And I studied... Tebow was my...
Wayne Tebow?
Wayne Tebow was my graduate advisor.
Mm-hmm.
I studied under Wayne. And I studied under Ralph Johnson. And the time the university had money to have visiting people come.
I see.
So we had Robert Mallory one semester from New York. We had Elaine de Kooning. It was a very rich time for me.
Uh-huh. And what were those years?
I got my master's and graduated in 66.
Uh-huh. So it was 62, 63,
64, 65. 63, 66, something like that, because I took beginning courses. I not beginning, but I took other courses that I needed to fill in.
Right.
Because I only had a minor in art.
Right.
So I needed to fill in some units first.
Great.
Yeah, it was wonderful.
I'm going to ask you to come with me outside. I want to end. Margaret, I want to thank you for your sharing of your artistic life that you have done in these conversations, and for all that you have told us about your process and your journey as an artist.
Oh, you're very welcome. I've enjoyed it terribly.
And thank you for sharing your home and your beautiful surroundings, which have added so greatly to your paintings. And I end now this conversation